Allez, c'est parti. One can then define a complete polynomial T, and one can set the coefficient 0 of the polynomial equal to 2. When one does that, the polynomial T is still the same. But mathematically, it is not available. It would detract from the theory of mathematics, and that would could damage the theory by breaking that. Let's look at another example. Strings. So most programming languages have strings, and you also define a concatenation operator, it's like the same stuff here. But one of the rules of concatenation is that it's associative. So A plus plus B is parent to the left, plus plus C is the same as A plus plus B, plus plus B is the same to the right. But again, the theory does not define an operator to change the sequence element while keeping the sequence the same. This one actually, when languages do get right, for instance in Java, the type of piece.
Est-ce que là, ici, il y a des questions? Là, en fait, ce qui démontre, c'est qu'entre les mathématiques et la programmation, en mathématiques, quand vous passez d'une instruction à une autre, on ne modifie pas l'instruction précédente. Quand on fait x égale 1 à une instruction et ensuite à une autre instruction, on fait x égale 2. Non, ça ne marche pas ce que je dis. Ça, c'est la mutation, du coup. Mais en gros, ce qu'il explique, c'est que dans le slide précédent, même s'il se base sur des concepts mathématiques, il explique simplement que d'une instruction à une autre, on ne modifie pas les valeurs de l'instruction précédente. On ne fait que de la copie, en fait. Et là, ce qu'il montrait dans notre langage de programmation, comme on a l'habitude de coder, quand il montrait la classe polynomiale, c'est que là, on était capable d'aller contre ce que proposaient les mathématiques, c'est-à-dire de pouvoir faire de la mutation. C'est bon. En gros, c'est juste la chose qu'il faut retenir.
We find that there's really no place for mutation. First, the theories do not admit they don't have a mutation operator. And second, if you would add it, then it could, in fact, destroy useful laws in the field. And that leads to a new side of programming where we say, well, we want to contemplate in defining these theories, operators, which was in the empty expressive function. We want to avoid mutation. And if we are going to do without something, we want to gain something else. I think the gain is with a powerful way to extract and compose functions. The side of functional programming means avoid mutations, get new ways of extracting composed functions. In fact, there are two ways to look at functional programming, a restricted one and a more general one. In the restricted sense, functional programming just means programming without usable variables, without assignments to those variables, without loops and the other inherited control steps. So it takes a lot of things away. In the more general sense, functional programming means focusing on functions in the program, in the sense it gives you new capabilities to work with these functions. Particular functions can be values that are produced, consumed, and composed. All this can be done in any programming language, but it becomes much easier in a functional language. So then we can also look at functional languages in a restricted sense or in a more general sense. In the restricted sense, then a functional programming language is one that does not have any available variables, assignments, or it has a composed function. And in the wider sense, a functional programming language is one that enables the construction of elegant programs that focus on the function. In particular, functions in a functional programming language are first-class citizens. What does it mean? It means that essentially you can do with a function that you could do with any other piece of data. So you can define a string anywhere, you should be able to define a function anywhere, including inside other functions. Like any other value, you should be able to pass a function as a parameter to another function and return it as a result from a function. And as for other values, there will be a set of operators to compose functions into future functions. So what are some functional programming methods? In the restricted sense, there's not many. There are some subsets such as pure list or natural without the IO monarch or untyped perform IO. There's an experimental language SP, that was the one that Butler proposed. And there are some domain specific languages mostly in the XML domain. For example, RDXL, CSR, or query. In the wider sense, we see the list family of languages, starting with list, with common dialect, scheme, bracket, and closure. The ML family that has FML, OCaml, SR. As the most popular variant, Haskell, the full language, Scala, and also Smalltalk or Ruby. So you might be surprised to see the last one in the list of functional languages, because they generally come with object-oriented languages. But since both of these languages have a construct of blocks, which are essentially just our functional values that you can pass along, I think it's fair to also adopt them in the functional family. Another example of that is JavaScript, which has a similar capability. So if you look at the history of functional programming languages, we find that they date back to almost the beginning of programming languages in general. The first functional language was Lisp, invented by McCarthy at the end of the 1950s. Then there was a lot of activities in the 1970s and 80s with ML, SP, Scheme, Markov, Pascal and Erlang. Later languages include Othello 2000, Scala 2003, Eckhart 2005, and Zelda 2007. So to find out more about functional programming, I recommend this book, Cluster and Interpretation of Computer Programs, by Howard Edelson and Charles Klugman, the second edition appeared at MIT Press in 1996. That book is an absolute classic when it comes to computer science. Many parts of our course and also the physics are based on it, but we change the language from scene to style. If you want to find out more about Scala, then I have to recommend my own book, of course, called Programming in Scala by myself, Les Spoon and Bill Leonard. It also appears in second edition at Athena Press 2010. And that's an attempt to standard language introduction to Scala and standard language lesson. There are many other books published about functional programming in general, and Scala in particular. I only took out three to recommend, but there are many other courses. First recommendation is Scala for Education by Kai Wolfman. That is a class-based introduction for people who already know Scala well. The second one is the writing book Programming in Scala. And the third one is called Scala in Depth by Sapiris, as the name implies that book goes quite a bit further than the other introduction text. You can find links to all of these books on the course site. And if I open up the course site and go to a different resources, then I see the text, the link for all the books here. And quite a few of them are actually available online, either as full text or in past. And I'll give you a quick introduction to functional programming and why it matters. I stress that there are simpler reasoning principles and better modularity, but there's actually a third reason why functional programming is becoming increasingly popular. And that's because it's very good for exploiting parallelism on multi-core and self-computing. To find out more about this third aspect, there's actually a video that I gave last year at the Oxfam Java conference. It is called Curtain Hard to Keep It Simple, and you get that also from the site. So you find the slides of the video here, and the talk you find here. I recommend that you go now to that talk to find out a little bit more about Scala, what its role is, what its purpose is, and why functional programming is important for parallelism. After you've done that, you can come to the next lecture where we are going to do some Scala programming.
Pas de questions? Le bouquin de d'Oderski, c'est comme la, pour ceux qui l'ont eu, la Bible PHP 5. C'est un bouquin qui fait cette épaisseur-là, et c'est très orienté language design en fait. Donc, il est peut-être plus intéressant, de, si vous voulez acheter un bouquin sur Scala, de soit prendre le programme, Functional Programming in Scala, le bouquin rouge, parce que celui-là est très réputé dans la communauté, ou le Scala for the Impatient, parce que le gros bouquin de d'Oderski, à titre perso, en fait, c'est très orienté language design. Pourquoi est-ce qu'il a fait ses constructions de cette manière-là? Et il explique toutes les constructions de Scala. Donc c'est très très bas niveau, et c'est assez lourd à lire en fait. Ouais, c'est ça, hein. Il n'y a pas un micro là qu'on peut couper?
On tient commande là, normalement.
A lot of the material in the session will look very easy to you because it's family. But there are also some things that are fundamental, in particular the formal model of evaluation that we call a substitution model, which will be very important for the session later on. So it's good to pay a little attention. Okay, let's get into it. Every non-trivial language provides primitive expressions that represent the simplest elements of the language, and then some way to combine expressions and way to abstract expressions. Abstraction means that we introduce a name for an expression, and then further on we can reference the expression by its name. One way to approach functional programming is to see it a little bit like a calculator. In fact, most functional languages have an interaction shell, that's also something we call your REPL, which stands for read, eval, print, loop. In that shell, you can type expressions and will respond with the result of the expression. In Scala, you can start the REPL simply by typing Scala, like Scala here, then you get the REPL. That assumes that you have a standard Scala distribution. That's actually not a requirement for this course. For the course, we ask you to install FTP, the Scala build tool instead. From the FTP, you can also get a REPL simply by typing FTP console. It's the same REPL, so it doesn't matter whether you start at the Scala and FTP console. Once you're in the REPL, you can type expressions by FTP. You can also define values. And the REPL, what you need to say is respond. If you have an expression with the expression type, in the case that it's int and the expression value, if you have a definition like radius, it will just give you the type of the definition. You can also define floating point numbers, and afterwards you can refer to what we have defined before. Now, let's have a look at evaluation. We have seen how the expressions were evaluated. How exactly did that happen? Well, the rules are well known from simple algebra. To evaluate a non-primitive expression, we typically take the leftmost operator, subject to the rules of precedence. We evaluate the operand of that operator.
Qui ici peut dire ce qu'est la rules of precedence dans un langage de programmation? Du coup, fallait le dire. Oui? Oui, c'est la priorité d'exécution des opérateurs. Donc dans chaque langage, ils ont chacun leur priorité d'exécution des opérateurs, avec par exemple les plus, multiplier, etc. Donc c'est pour ça qu'ils parlent de l'évaluation des opérandes, ben ça dépend aussi de la précédence des opérateurs.
And for the moment, a value is just a number. Later on, you'll also consider other kinds of values. So let's see an example. Here's the evaluation of the arithmetic expression 2 times pi times radius. What's happening there? First thing we do is we look up the name pi, and we get its definition 3.14159. Then we perform the arithmetic operation on the left. Then we look up the radius, evaluate radius, we open 10, and finally, we perform the final multiplication using the result. Definitions can also have parameters. For instance, we can define a square function by writing def square, then comes the parameter x of type double, and then comes the right hand side x times x. The right hand side refers to the parameter x. And the evaluation then would yield the expected square of 2, which is 4, square of 5 plus 4, which is 91. We can, of course, also have parameterized definitions that refer to parameterized functions as in the sum of squares function here that takes two parameters, x and y, as double, and it computes the square x and square y and sums them. We've seen in the last slide that function parameters come with their type, and the type is given after the parameter name and the colon in Scala. So you would write x colon double, y colon int. You can also give the return type of a function that follows after the parameter. The primitive types are written as in Java, but they are capitalized. So int, for example, is a 32-bit integer, double is a 64-bit floating point number, and boolean represents the boolean type of values true and false. Now, how are function applications evaluated? In fact, they are evaluated in a way that's very similar to operators. We first evaluate all function arguments going from left to right. We then replace the function application by the function's right-hand side. And at the same time, we replace the former parameters of the function by the actual argument. Let's see how this works in an example. We start with sum of squares of 3 and 2 plus 2. The 2 plus 2 gets rewritten to a value 4, and we have sum of squares 3, 4. Then we take the definition of sum of squares, that was square of x plus square of y, and we replace the application by the right hand side. where at the same time we replace the parameters x and y by the actual arguments 3 and 4. We then repeat the process with the square application. Square of 3 becomes 3 times 3, the right hand side of square, where 3 replaces the parameter x. We get an arithmetic simplification, and we do the same thing for the right hand operator, yielding the final value 25. This is not a special evaluation from the substitution model. The idea underlying this model is that all evaluation does is reduce instruction to a value. And that reduction can be expressed by a sequence of simple rewriting steps that rewrites the step in turn itself until it is a value. Very similar to what we would do in exercise simplification. Simply as it is, this model is very powerful. In fact, it has been shown that it can express every algorithm or equivalent to what we call a Turing machine. This has been shown a long time before bunch of programming, in fact, a long time before computers, by a logician called Alonzo Church in the Lambda Cycles. He did that in the 30s of the last century. You might have come across Lambda Cycles in your computer science, and if you did, then you know how to make the connection to this model. If you didn't, don't worry, you want to meet the theory for following the course. What's important, though, is to know that Lambda Cycles is a model, and it's models can be applied only to expressions that do not have a side effect. Now, what is a side effect? A typical side effect would be an expression called C, where C is a variable, and evaluating this expression means that you return the old value of C, and at the same time you increment the value, and so the next time you return the value, it would return a value one larger than before. Turns out there's no good way to represent this evaluation sequence by a simple rewriting of the term. You need something else, like store the return value of the data. In other words, the expression C++ has a side effect on the current value of the variable, and that side effect cannot be expressed. So one of the motivations for moving out the side effects in bunch of programming is that we can keep the simple model in the lecture. Once we have the substitution model, another question comes up. Set every expression reduced to a value and a finite number of steps. In fact, the answer is no. Here's a counterexample. Let's write a simple function def loop int equals loop. And let's then refer to the name loop. What would happen? Well, according to our model, we have to evaluate that name, which happens by replacing the name by its right hand side. The right hand side is loop again. So we have reduced the name to itself. And this then goes on at infinitum. Another way to visualize this reduction sequence is by starting with loop and then reducing to the same term again. We've seen that the parametric reduces function arguments to values before rewriting the function application. That's not the only possible reduction strategy. Alternatively, one could apply the function to unreduced arguments. For instance, we could start with sum of squares 3, 2 plus 2, and then go on as follows. We see the right hand side, we don't reduce it to 4, we simply pass it as an expression to the square function. We then simplify the right hand side as before, and then do the same thing again, pass the expression 2 plus 2 to this occurrence of square that gives 2 plus 2 twice in the multiplication. We then simplify it in two further steps to arrive at the final result, 25. Now you've seen two ways to evaluate the same expression. The first evaluation strategy is known as call by value, the second is known as call by name. The important theorem, back of Lambda calculus, is that both strategies reduce to the same final value as long as the reduced expression consists of pure functions and both evaluations terminate. Call by value has the advantage that every function argument is evaluated only once. Call by name has the advantage that a function argument is not evaluated at all if the corresponding parameter is not used in the evaluation of the function's value. Here's a question. Then you're given the following function definition, def test of x and y equals x times x. For each of the following function applications, indicate which evaluation strategy is fastest. That is, we mean, has the fewest reduction steps. First test of 2, 3, then test of 3 plus 4, 8, test 7, 2 times 4, and finally, test 3 plus 4, 2 times 4.
Mm-hmm. Alors du coup, donc on a le callback value et callback name. Ça dépend des langages de programmation. Dans certains langages, on ne peut pas dire... alors déjà, qui a bien compris le principe de callback name? Voilà, donc du coup, pour revenir... Je ne sais pas si on peut revenir avant. Mince. J'ai l'impression que ça marche. Non, c'est pas grave. Le truc, c'est qu'ici... Alors, il dit de manière un peu intelligente, mais en fait, ici, si vous faites du call by name, ça veut dire que 2 plus 2, tant qu'il n'est pas utilisé dans le corps de la fonction, tant qu'on ne va pas l'utiliser pour faire un calcul supplémentaire, il ne va pas être calculé. Et nous, on n'a pas l'habitude, parce que dans les langages de programmation habituels, quand on fait ça, on sait que 2 plus 2 va être évalué avant même d'appeler sum of square. Et le call by name dit simplement que ça, 2 plus 2, et même ça sera un appel de fonction, il ne serait pas évalué tout de suite, il sera évalué que lorsque dans le corps de sum of square ou dans des appels plus bas dans la hiérarchie, on en aura besoin. Et du coup, forcément, le call by name, c'est bien plus efficace et performant que le call by value. Parce que le call by value, ça veut dire que vous allez à chaque fois, avant d'appeler une fonction, évaluer les arguments qu'on lui passe. Alors que le call by name, un argument pourrait être une... Ici, ça pourrait être une fonction qui prend 10 secondes à être exécutée. Eh bien, si sum of square n'en a jamais besoin, il nous retourne une autre fonction qui a besoin de ça, en fait, cette fonction-là ne sera jamais exécutée tant qu'on n'appellera pas la fonction qui nous a été retournée. Donc, du coup, c'est extrêmement efficace. Donc, dans la question qu'il posait, quel est le plus efficace entre le call by value et le call by name? Bah, forcément, le call by name, puisque vous allez avoir les arguments que vous passez ne seront pas forcément évalués si on n'en a pas besoin. Alors, ça par contre, c'est jusqu'à là. Bah là où c'est intéressant, c'est l'exemple qu'il donnait justement là. C'était ici, je crois. Non, même pas. Bah, de toute façon, oui. Si, en fait, il y a trois approches. Il y a call by name, call by value et call by... Bon, allez voir sur la page Wikipédia. Il y a une troisième approche. C'est call by référence, je crois. Ouais, c'est ça, call by référence. Et du coup, ça, c'est les trois approches. Dans les langages habituels, genre type JavaScript, je vais pas dire de bêtises, mais PHP, je pense aussi, et bon, je vais pas me lancer sur les autres langages, vous avez le call by value et le call by référence. On a l'habitude du call by référence aussi. Tandis que là, dans certains langages, on a aussi le call by name, que vous pouvez spécifier. Bon, de toute façon, on va le voir après la suite du cours. Là où ça a un intérêt, c'est qu'ici. Ouais, c'est ça.
Je pense pas. Je pense qu'après c'est optimisé à la compilation, c'est-à-dire qu'une fois qu'il a évalué, il sait que c'est partout.
Ah oui. Parle plus fort, je suis pas sûr qu'ils aient entendu là-bas.
C'est dans ce cas-là, je pense que tu appelles le paramètre, ça va évaluer.
Tu vas rentrer dans le lazy val là?
Non.
tu la signes pour éviter qu'elle soit réévaluée tout le temps.
Là, en tout cas, ce qu'il dit sur cet exemple-là, on voit bien qu'on a test x fois x, et qu'on n'utilise pas y. Donc du coup, ici, sur cette dernière approche, en fait, le 2 fois 4, il n'est jamais calculé dans le cadre du call by name, parce qu'on n'utilise jamais y, en fait. On n'utilise que la partie x de gauche. Et ici aussi, d'ailleurs.
Ah, pas toujours.
Oui,
parfois,
mais
c'est conditionnel.
C'est ça. Parfois, c'est conditionnel. Parfois, ça serait un appel à la base de données. Et il y aura une condition dans le corps de la fonction qui appellerait ou non la base de données en fonction du premier paramètre. Voilà, là, ça a du sens de faire du call by name, effectivement. Oui. Ça s'applique plus à des... Oui. C'est toujours une question de balance, de toute façon. Après, peut-être un factoriel qui pourrait être problématique. Enfin, voilà. Ok, allez, on avance. Faut pas regarder la traduction.
And in fact, it would reduce to 4 under both evaluation strategies, both call by name and call by value, because we have started with already evaluated arguments, so there is no choice in the matter. So here the answer would be that we are at the same complexity. Let's do the next one. Test 3 plus 4, 8. Under call by value, we have to evaluate the arguments. So we get test 7. And that gives us 7 times 7. And so, right under call by name, we get 3 plus 4 times 3 plus 4. That reduces to 7 times 3 plus 4. 7 times 7 and 49. In one step more than the call by value version. So call by value has the advantage here. Let's look at the third example, test of 7 and 2 times 4. Here with call by value we would get a test of 7 and 8. Finally 7 times 7. And whereas with call by name we would get 7 times 7, 49. So in this case we have avoided the unnecessary computation of the system argument and call by name is faster. The fourth example test 3 plus 4 to 2 times 4. Combines the evaluations of the second and third example, so it comes as no surprise that it's again a draw, the call by value and call by name that would use in the same number of steps there. Angela?
Oui, question. Vous voulez le sous-titre en anglais ou en français? Merde. Qui le veut en anglais? Qui le veut en français? Ah, mais normalement, c'est le français qui gagne. Ouais. Du coup, on va le laisser en français pour ceux qui le veulent en français, parce que sinon, c'est difficile. Quoi.
Last session, we have explored a formal model of evaluation of expressions, which is called the substitution model. And we have seen that there's more than one way to evaluate an expression. We've identified the call by name and call by value evaluation strategy. And in this session, we're going to compare them a little bit further, in particular, in what regards termination. But if we look at call by name and call by value and how they relate to termination, then we know that both the various strategies will always reduce the same value, provided that the evaluation is terminated. But what if the evaluations do not terminate? We have seen in the last session that some of these expressions actually do not give a value in a finite number of steps. So there we have an important theorem which says that if the call by value evaluation of an expression terminates, then the call by name evaluation of that same expression will terminate also. And furthermore, the other direction is not true. So call by name termination does not imply call by value termination. So let's see an example. Can you find an expression that terminates under call by name, but not under call by value? Okay, so let's see how we would go about that. We define a function first that takes simply two parameters, x and y, and returns the first one x, so it forgets about one. And then we consider the expression first of one and loop. So we pass a non-terminating computation into the second parameter. Under call by name, what will happen? Well, call by name will reduce the first expression without reducing the argument. So it would just yield one in a single step. the first argument. And the variation would stop in a value, obviously. And according to value, we have to reduce the arguments to this expression. So we have to reduce loop. And we already know that loop reduces to itself. So we would reduce the arguments infinitely often. The whole expression would always reduce to itself, and we would make no progress. So that's another example of an infinite loop. In Scala, we normally use call by value. You might ask, well, given the advantages of call by name, that it terminates more often, why call by value? But it turns out that for expressions in practice, call by value is often exponentially more efficient than call by name, because it avoids this repeated recomputation of argument expressions that call by name entails. The other argument for call by value is that it plays much nicer with the imperative effects and side effects, because you tend to know much better when expressions will be evaluated. Then Scala has also an imperative side, call by value is dependent choice. Except that sometimes you really want to force call by name, and Scala lets you do that also. You do that by adding an arrow in front of the parameter type. So this function const1 takes an x parameter int and a y parameter of type arrow int, and that means that the parameter y is also an int, but it will be passed call by name. So to demonstrate the difference between the two parameters, let's trace the evaluations of two expressions, const1, 1 plus 2 loop, and const1 loop in 1 plus 2.
Donc il fallait emmener un petit papier du coup.
Bien.
Merde. Ouais. Bon, en fait, oui, c'est ce qui est mis là, du coup.
Oui, mais...
Qu'est-ce qu'on voit là? Bon, en plus, il te retourne 1. Donc, il évalue jamais, en fait.
Ah, sauf par value.
Ouais, sauf ici, là.
Donc, il y a un cas où c'est infini et l'autre où c'est en...
Ouais. Donc, du coup, tout le monde a fait l'exercice? Ouais? Ouais?
Bah, ici, vous avez donc le deuxième paramètre qui est par name et le premier par value. Ça vous retourne 1. Donc, on n'utilise jamais finalement x et y. Néanmoins, ici, quand ça s'est évalué, y n'est jamais évalué. Donc on a... Parce que loop, en fait, on est bien d'accord que c'est loop, il s'appelle lui-même à chaque fois qu'on l'appelle. Donc c'est pour ça que ça fait une boucle infinie. Donc là, comme ça, c'est jamais évalué. En fait, ce qui se passe, c'est que ça retourne 1. Et par contre, 1 plus 2 est évalué avant. Donc, 1 plus 2 est évalué avant, ça fait 3, et ensuite on retourne 1. Tandis que dans le deuxième cas, où là on a loop en premier, bah, loop est d'abord évalué, parce qu'ici on a un call by value, plutôt qu'un call by name. Donc loop est d'abord évalué, et c'est ça qui fait la boucle infinie. Donc en réalité, const1, le corps de const1 n'est jamais appelé. Tout le monde est d'accord, avec ça? Ok. Donc bah du coup, ouais bah on l'a fait. C'est très bien.
The first one, const 1 plus 2 loop, is, well the first parameter is called by value, so we have to reduce that to 3, so that will be 3, and the rest will be
cast. Bon maintenant.
The second parameter we do not need to reduce because it's a call by name parameter. So we are done with the argument list, we can apply the function, and the function would just always reduce to 1, so it would in fact be ignore both of its parameters. That's the first expression. The second expression here, we would have const 1 of loop and 1 plus 2. Well, here we have to reduce the first argument because it's called by value, and we get into the same situation that loop reduces to itself, so no progress, and we get another infinite cycle. So far, our syntactic vocabulary was really minimal. Essentially, all we had were functions and function applications. In this week, we are going to introduce two more syntax constructs, namely conditionals and value definitions. In every language, we need a way to use particular values. For that, Scala has to be a conditional expression, else. It looks like an if else in Java, but it's used for expressions, not statements. You see an example here. you define an absolute factor, which type of it, right? And then, well, if x greater or equal to 0, it's otherwise minus it. What you see here is that the if else is actually an expression, it's not a statement where you have to set an error bar set to an expression. The x greater than 0 here is an expression of type Boolean, and that expression is sometimes called predicate. So Boolean expressions are formed actually the same way as the data, so you will put by 2 or 4 as a true constant, not the magnitude and the rotation, conduction, and another view would be able to see and this junction is a double bar, and you would have to use a comparison operator from equal quality inequality to only comparison. Generally, if an expression is a legal expression in Java, then you can expect it to be a legal expression in Java as well. Okay, so you see now the syntax is okay, the Boolean expression, but what about their meaning? And we have to define meaning by the substitution model, and we're going to do the same thing for Boolean. So, how do we define meaning for Boolean expression? Well, just by doing a read-write rule, that you can see on the left, some template for Boolean expression, and on the right, how they would rewrite. Take the first one, not true, which is false, not false, which is true. Third rule is about and conduction. It says true and some other expression E, that's how we do this, would always be the same as E. And false and some other expression E would always be false. The rules for or are analogous to the rules for and. What's interesting about that is that and or don't always use their right operand, but it's easier to be evaluated. Whenever you write E, you get the past answer. And here, for instance, if it falls and E, if it falls, you would have that always without even looking inside the expression E. So E doesn't need to be evaluated. And if there's a deep expression, you expose them to be evaluated. Of course, the expressions in most other programming languages. But now we have a concise model that shows that we can rule for language patterns. So let's see how we thought about that. We're looking for read-write rules for expressions of the following form. This is it, some condition Boolean, some then part E1, else some part E2.
Whoa. Ah, il faut refaire cette liste-là du coup. Est-ce qu'on est vraiment obligé de faire cet exercice? Par contre, le truc à retenir par rapport aux autres langages qui est nouveau, c'est le fait que en Scala, on n'a pas toutes les structures conditionnelles sont des expressions et ne sont pas des déclarations. C'est-à-dire que une structure qui a un if else, qui a un try catch, vous pouvez faire var, enfin let a égale val a pardon, val a égale try et votre catch. Et en fait, a va contenir le résultat du try catch. Donc la partie, le bloc try, s'il fonctionne, vous allez avoir le résultat dans votre variable, enfin dans votre valeur A. Et le catch, si on arrive dans le catch, vous allez avoir le résultat dans A. Et c'est pareil pour les if. Et c'est pour ça qu'en JavaScript, il y a une librairie qu'on utilise maintenant qui s'appelle ifexp, qui vous permet d'avoir les expressions en JavaScript. Donc d'avoir la même chose qu'en Scala, mais en JavaScript, parce qu'en JavaScript, on ne peut pas avoir ça non plus. Et ça, c'est vraiment un truc super cool qu'on retrouve maintenant dans d'autres langages aussi.
Hop. One of the things as well, one would have been like one well would be like this event bar one. And conversely, if the condition is false, then the condition would be like
event bar
two. So those are the two rules that we are asked to clarify if the condition are complete. Here's another piece of information that you see the function parameters can be
qu'est-ce qui se passe?
value. For instance, if you write val x equals 2 and then val y equals square of x, then the square of x would be evaluated right here instead of when we first refer to the name y. So the right-hand side of a value definition is evaluated at the point of the definition itself, and afterwards the name refers to the value. So in our case, the y reference here would refer to the number 4.
That's quite cool.
Not to the expression.
Oh. Ah, c'est que les télés n'étaient pas encore synchronisées, peut-être. C'est pour ça qu'on n'avait pas le son.
Elles sont avant le
billet. Alors, du coup. Benjamin, réponse. Quand il dit for all argument expression, c'est que tu passes par des. C'est pas. J'allais partir sur des types paramétriques, mais c'est pas ça. Ah oui, d'accord, ok. Et. Là, il leur précise des types, mais tu passes sur des types int, du coup ?
Ouais, je pense que c'est un boulet.
Alors.
Oui, c'est ça, oui, c'est ça.
Il n'y a pas de zen, non? Ok. if x. Ah oui, bien vu. Et sinon, si c'est false, bah c'est false, du coup. Il est false, bien vu. Ça marche comme ça. Bon, il y a deux choses qu'on a vues juste avant. Pour déclarer une valeur, on va plutôt passer par val. Et ce n'est pas des var comme en JavaScript, c'est vraiment des valeurs. Donc vous pourrez, c'est une constante, on ne peut pas la réassigner, on ne peut pas la muter. Pour déclarer des fonctions, c'est par def. Donc on a fonction en JavaScript, je prends l'exemple de JavaScript à chaque fois parce que tout le monde connaît à peu près ça. Mais donc ici, c'est def. Et du coup, bah, peut-être que tu veux en rajouter un peu. Non ? Bon. Et du coup, là, on définit une fonction qui a deux arguments, x et y. On voit que pour définir le type, on dit d'abord le nom d'argument, deux points, le type. Donc là, c'est booléen. Ensuite, on fait égal pour donner le corps de la fonction. On pourrait mettre aussi des accolades si c'était sur plusieurs lignes. Mais comme là, il n'y a pas d'accolade, comme là, il n'y a pas plusieurs lignes, on peut directement le faire comme ça. Et comme les expressions conditionnelles, les conditions sont des expressions, on peut directement faire cette fonction-là, son corps. Son résultat, ça sera if de x, donc si x est vrai, alors y, parce que si x est vrai, alors y est ici. Sinon, bah comme x était faux, on retourne false, parce que c'est vrai que si x est false ici, y sera jamais évalué, et tout ça sera égal à false. Et le résultat de cette condition-là, bah en fait, ça va être le résultat de notre end ici. Boolean, c'est avec un B majuscule, en ce cas-là ? Ouais. Et on s'est fait rejeter.
Oui, c'est apparemment sur cela, il y a un truc de petit slash.
En fait, sur cela, il y a un problème, il y a des histoires de petit slash, et même si tu mets la bonne réponse,
ça ne dira pas. Alors, Célia nous dit qu'elle a déjà fait l'exercice et que ça ne fonctionne pas dans tous les cas.
Ok.
Bah oui, mais x, il est déjà false en fait. Donc tu peux le mettre. Si tu mets x. Ok, donc ça marche.
False. En fait, ça va false tout le temps.
Non, sauf si tu fais trop. Ouais, voilà, donc le code est valide, mais on ne sait pas ce qu'il attend. Tac tac, je reviens. Bon, pareil. De toute façon, on va avoir la réponse après. Ouais, de toute façon.
Okay. Let's think about how we would write the and function. Well, one guideline would be let's just look at the rewrite rule for and. That says, well, if the first condition is true, then it would rewrite the second one. Why? If the first condition is false, then the result would be false. And true.
Mais ça marche pareil. Quelle est la réponse ? Hein ? Une flèche, exactement. On passe par name plutôt que par value, ce qui fait que y sera évalué que si x est vrai.
In this session, we are going to apply what we learned so far in the larger example. The task is to develop a square root function using Newton's method. That's the first time that we need more than a couple of lines to actually express a program, and we will learn new techniques and new tools for doing so. So what that means is that we want to define a function with a signature, we take the double, packet bubble and the return value is the square root of its parameter x. The classical way to compute that is by successive approximations using the method of Isaac Newton. So let's see what this method is. To compute square root of x, we start with an initial estimate value. It doesn't really matter what that estimate is as long as it's positive. So let's pick y equals 1. And then we repeatedly improve the estimate by taking the mean of the old estimate y and the value of x divided by y, where x is the value we want to draw the root of. So let's see that in action. So the value of x in our example would be 2. Our initial estimation is 1 as usual, so the initial quotient is 2 divided by 1, that's 2, the mean is 1.5. Now we plug in 1.5 to our estimation, we get a new quotient of 1.33, a new mean that we see here, and you see that it converges very quickly to the actual value. So now we have an abstract algorithm. Let's see how we would put that into a function that computes that algorithm. A typical way to code algorithms in functional languages is to go step by step. So we take a small task and formulate it as a function, and then probably that task will need further tasks that then would be defined in their own function. The first function we want to define is the actual iteration, called the square root iter, which says, well, if we have a guess and the value which we want to draw the root from, what do we do? Well, either we stop the iteration and return a result, or we go and do another iteration step. The predicate that controls that, give it a name, it's called is good enough. So if my guess is good enough, then I just can return the guess. If my guess is not yet good enough, then I have to improve my guess. Let's do that with another function, improve, and call square root iter again with the improved guess. So the square root iter is recursive, so its right-hand side calls itself. One similarity in Scala is that the return type of a recursive function needs to be given always, whereas for other functions it's optional. The reason for that is that to compute that return type, the Scala compiler would have to look at the right-hand side, and because the square root iter function is recursive, it's stuck in a cycle. It would need the return type for that to compute the type for the expression. To break the cycle, we require that recursive functions always have explicit return types. It actually makes sense even for other publicly used functions to give an explicit return type because that's good documentation that is not required by the language. Okay, so let's implement this in practice. What we're going to see is a new way to write programs. So far, we have done everything in the level. Now, for larger programs, we have something that's better adapted. We go into Eclipse and we start a worksheet. So I take you through the steps one by one. Here we have an empty Eclipse thing. We first start a new project, a project. Call it demand the name, call it prop fun for the course. And then in the project, what we can do is define a package, which is essentially a directory, in which we are going to put all of the stuff from this week, or this week one. We don't need to define packages, but it's good practice to keep stuff tidy and ordered. And then in that package, we define a new sheet. It is a name, let's call it session. In a worksheet, what we can do is we can type expressions and have them evaluated, just like in a repo. We can do 1 plus 2, and the expressions get evaluated when we hit save, that would be command S or control S. But the expressions show up on the right, in a different color, as you see here.
Vous avez ça aussi avec les workbooks directement dans IntelliJ une fois que vous installez le plugin Scala.
And edit expressions, and the re-evaluation will then show the edited value. So it's not just a single line editing window, but a whole window that you can use. So let's use the worksheet to complete our square root function. First thing I'm going to do is take it from the slide. So I select square root iter here, and paste it inside the worksheet. I can reformat with the control shift F, so that would format things nicely. But the worksheet still doesn't compile because, of course, I have two functions here that I haven't yet defined. But if it is good enough, and improve. So for if good enough, let's do that first. So if good enough, takes the same parameters as iter and it returns a boolean that says whether we can stop the iteration or whether we need more steps. So what could that predicate be? Well, one way to do it would be to say, well, if we take the current guess here, we square it. If we're close enough to the original value x, then guess by itself would be close enough to the desired square root value. So let's code that up. You can say guess times guess minus x, you would have to take the absolute value of that. And it would have to be smaller than some epsilon value, let's say 0, 0, 1 for the moment. Okay, so that was number one. The second function we need to define is improve. And that's now the core of the Newton method. Is that we say, well, if we take a guess and an x, and to improve the guess, what do we do? Well, we say we need to take the mean of the value, the current value of guess at the quotient of x divided by guess. So to take the average, we would sum the two values and then divide by two. Good. Now we have a worksheet that compiles. You see here on the right hand side, you see all the types. The last function we need to define is framework itself. So let's do that. What would that be? Well, it would be the square root iteration with our first initial value, because that was 1.0 and x. But now we have all the elements in place, and we can start to test our function. Let's start with square root of 2. And we get 1.4142, so that looks right. Let's do another one, square root of 4. And we get something close to 2 as you would expect. So,
alors juste une petite parenthèse sur ce qu'on a vu avant, parce qu'il n'a pas trop précisé, mais là, là pourquoi c'est important de préciser la valeur de retour sur les fonctions de récursive, ça permet au compilateur Scala de faire de ce qu'on appelle le tail recursive optimization. C'est-à-dire que, par exemple, en JavaScript, on n'a pas encore ce support-là, mais ça arrive bientôt. Dans des langages comme plein de langages, en fait, il y a plein de langages qui ne supportent pas ça. Qu'est-ce que ça fait, en fait? C'est qu'au moment où il va faire la récursion ici, il va, au lieu de garder toute la call stack à chaque fois qu'il fait des appels successifs, des appels récursifs, et donc à la fin avoir un stack overflow, la telle recursive optimization, donc vous pouvez avoir ça sur Wikipédia, il donne plein d'exemples, en fait, ce que ça fait, c'est que ça va garder juste la valeur intermédiaire et dire, tu dois me rappeler la première fonction qui a été appelée en retournant le résultat. Il ne garde pas les appels successifs, en fait. Salut.
Ah bon, bah parfait. Du coup,
ça, c'était le premier point. Et le second point, vous remarquez aussi que par rapport à d'autres langages, vous n'avez pas besoin de préciser en amont les fonctions que vous allez utiliser dans le cœur, dans le corps de vos fonctions suivantes. En ce cas-là, ce qu'il fait, c'est qu'il évalue tout, et ensuite, vous avez accès à tous les keywords. Mais ce n'est pas le cas dans d'autres langages type script. Je ne vais pas parler pour Python, mais en tout cas pour JavaScript, on sait que si vous faites vous définissez des fonctions qui ne sont pas des déclarations de fonctions, mais qui sont des expressions, vous ne pouvez pas les utiliser tant qu'elles n'ont pas été définies précédemment. Et donc ici, là, on n'a pas ce problème-là, parce qu'il utilise dans SquareIter isGoodEnough, alors qu'il définit ensuite.
So, as an exercise, I would like you to think about the implementation we have so far and try to improve it. One thing to improve is that the isGoodEnough test is not very precise for small numbers, and it can lead to non-termination for very, very large numbers. So here, let me demonstrate that. Let's take a very small number, let's say 1 to the minus 6, so 1 over a million. So our square root, the square root we would expect to see is 1 over minus 3, and actually what we see is 0.03, so that's pretty far away from where we want to be. And the other problem we have is if we take a large one, let's say 1 to 16th power, what would we see then? And actually what we see is non-termination. You see this here with this little bar, and it says, well, it doesn't find the square root. Not so good, let me take that out. Okay. So can you explain why that is? Why is the isGoodEnough test not precise for small numbers, and why can we do non-termination for very large numbers?
On s'arrête à 0,01, mais surtout si ton chiffre de départ est plus petit que ça, c'est pas représentatif. Non, ça parle de la précision finale. Et puis après, c'est difficile, il demande de réfléchir après.
Et est-ce que là, du coup.
Par contre, ce que je comprends pas, c'est comment ce résultat.
Attends, c'est qu'il passe x. Donc il fait moins x à chaque fois, en fait, ouais. Il passe le...
Ça va être calculé. Oui, sauf que moins le film, moins 0,00. Je comprends pas comment ce truc peut être inférieur à 0,001, sachant que son résultat est clairement supérieur. Et que le x il est tout petit. Ouais, non, parce qu'il aurait dit.
Qui a des réponses? On avance? On aura les réponses après?
Ouais. C'est pas évident pour les papiers.
Ouais. Alors, je sais pas si.
You find a different version of the Twitter app that doesn't have these problems.
Attends. Donc il a déjà donné la réponse à la première, c'est ça?
Here are some numbers to test your version, some very small and some very large numbers. So, to answer that exercise, let's go back to our worksheet. The problem we had for both small numbers and large numbers was that our it's good enough test is takes an absolute difference. It asks whether the absolute difference between the square of guess and x is less than some threshold value. And that's not very good for very, very small numbers because the number we want to find in the square root might even be smaller than that. So that, relatively speaking, that absolute value might be huge compared to the number we want to find. And for very large numbers, we have the opposite problem, which is that very large floating point numbers can actually be further apart than this epsilon value. That means in the 52 bits they have available for the antithesis, it could be that the distance between one number and the next is actually larger than 0.001. And in that case, of course, the correction can never stop, simply because there is no value that ever good enough. So we can solve both problems by making the test proportional to x. That's very simply done by saying, okay, let's divide the absolute difference by the current value of x, and let's make that be smaller than the threshold value. So once I've done that, I can simply re-evaluate my spreadsheet, and now I would see that everything completes nicely. And for the small number, I get something very close to 1 to e minus 3, as expected. And for the large number, I get something like e 1 to e 30, and that also adds that one. The program we developed in the last session consisted of many small bits and pieces. In this session, we are going to develop a fundamental structuring mechanism based on blocks and lexical scoping that will help us clean up our program, make it more modular and easier to use. We are going to apply that mechanism to our previous square root function. It's good programming style, particularly function program, split up the task into many small functions. But on the other hand, names like square root iter and do, which is good enough, they really matter only for the implementation of square root, not for its users. Normally, we would not like users to access these functions directly, so we want to avoid namespace pollution where they would see these names even though they're not supposed to be called directly by them. One way you can achieve that is to put these auxiliary functions inside the function square root. Let me show that in that directly. What we have here so far is all these functions are separate and visible on the top level. So what I want to do now is I take my definition of square root and I wrap it around the functions that are on the inside here. So I do it like that, as reformat. And then what do we see? So we see the function square root that now contains where the data is good enough to be true, as well as the return value of square root. The return value here comes last. What that means is that now our program is not cleaner, the only function that's seen from the outside. We still have very good names for the individual subsets, but those are accessible only from inside. So the way we did that was using a block. A block is delimited by braces and it contains a number of definitions and a class expression that defines the return value and the result of that block. So here is the example. We have a definition of val, if, and the return is standard. Blocks are themselves expressions in class, so they can be used everywhere other expressions can be used, including the byte value of function. Now, an interesting aspect of blocks is how they affect the visibility of identifying the program. There are two simple rules. The first is the definitions inside the block are only visible from within the block, not from the outside. The second rule is the definitions from outside the block are visible in the block as long as they're not shadowed by the definitions of the same inside the block. So that means that, for instance, here the name F is visible in the block because
F3, C4, 4x4. Ah, il y a un plus X. Oh, le bâtard. X, c'est... Ouais, mais c'est 0, donc ouais. C'est 16.
Ah, il l'a mis.
Ah, le bâtard. J'avais pas vu le plus X.
Ouais, mais du coup, ça sert à rien, c'est dommage. Mais tu le vois pas, tu le prends pas. X, ça. C'est parce que si tu retournes pas la ligne, il faut que
c'est pas. C'est bon pour tout le monde, le 16? Non. Du coup, là, on a. Alors, ça, c'est le problème des scopes dans peu importe le langage. En français, on appelle ça la portée des variables. Là, ici, on a une déclaration de x égale à 0. Ensuite, on a une déclaration d'une fonction. Et ensuite, on a une déclaration d'un bloc. Donc, ça, c'est l'équivalent du do aussi en Ruby. Et dans ce bloc-là, on dit bah, on a une variable locale qui s'appelle x qui est égale à f2,3. Donc, f2,3, c'est 3 plus 1, ça fait 4. Donc, x ici est égal à 4. Et on a ce qu'on appelle du variable shadowing. Donc, le variable shadowing, c'est que le x. Et dans ce scope-là, on ne peut plus accéder à ce x qui est à l'extérieur du scope. Parce qu'on l'a shadow, on l'a caché. Donc ici, ça fait 4. On fait 4 fois 4. Donc c'est forcément le résultat de result. Comme on l'a dit, là, c'est une expression. Donc ça, ça vous retourne result égal à 4. Et en fait, on fait plus x qui, lui, est en dehors du scope, qui était ici. Donc de la portée. Et donc plus x, x est égal à 0. Donc ça fait 16. Voilà. Et donc, du coup, l'intérêt de pouvoir déclarer des fonctions dans des fonctions ou déclarer des fonctions dans des blocs, ça vous permet de faire de l'encapsulation. L'encapsulation qu'on retrouve après dans les langages de programmation aussi objets. C'est le même principe derrière, c'est qu'on va exposer uniquement ce qui est de l'API public. On n'expose pas l'API privée. On peut mettre autant de fois que
de conversion dans l'expression. Ouais, je pense. Tu peux chez des autant d'expressions que tu veux au niveau de l'assignation.
And the value we do see here is this first definition, that would be 0, from the answer of the whole expression to the answer of the whole expression, 15. So we've seen the definitions of outer scopes are available inside a box under the shadow. We can use that to simplify squares by eliminating the number of the currency of the x-parameter, which means everywhere the same thing. So what we see here in the worksheet is that the x-parameter that comes into square root is easy to be here, here, and here, but it's not a change. It's always passed as it is before. So we can simply eliminate all these occurrences here and eliminate the corresponding parameter in the application. And we have the same version of square root, but now it's much cleaner. We have avoided the redundancy of passing the parameter x around everywhere by using the simple fact that the value of x is actually visible inside all these empty functions. So let's give you another reason for nesting things. It's not just namespace control, but it's also reusing outer definitions without passing them explicitly. Okay, one thing we haven't mentioned so far were the forums. Because so far we haven't seen that. So in Java, every statement would be terminated by the forums. In Scala, they are in most cases optional. We could have written value equals one with a semicolon, but most people would admit that. The only situation where you really need a semicolon is if you want to put several definitions or expressions on one line. And then the semicolon is needed to separate them. So for instance, here we have a value definition of y equals x plus 1, and then a use of the variable y in a subsequent expression, and we need the semicolon needed to separate the two. Okay, we can commit the semicolon at the end of line, it's very close to the region, but there's one issue with it. How would you write an expression that spans several lines? The problem, consider this expression here, some long expression that is continuous on the second line with some other expression. That would actually be interpreted by this highlights two expressions. The first expression is the sum long expression, then would be the implied semicolon, and that comes plus with the other expression. There are two ways to overcome this problem. You could write the multi-line expressions in parentheses, because semicolons are never inserted inside a pair of parentheses. And you could write sum long expression plus sum other expression as long as you put it in parentheses, that's fine. Or the other way to do that is to write the operator on the first line as the last word of the first line. Because this tells the compiler that the expression is finished. So if a line ends in I would assume that the next time it won't start at the same time. So to summarize what you see with this, you see several elements of functional programming in Scala. Everybody can do it in presence, conditional expressions, if they help, functions with recursion, then you can take this one. You've learned the difference between call by name, call by value, and value strategy, and I believe most importantly, you've learned the way to reason about program execution, and how we use expressions using the substitution model. That model would be a
dans la pratique qu'on utilise, tous les points de vue, ça va jamais.
Une autre question ? Parle fort pour que tout le monde entende. En fait, alors ça c'est une bonne question, et du coup la question c'est, par exemple dans cet exemple-là, c'est pas le même, ah, c'était le cours d'avant, dans l'exemple avant on avait une fonction qui contenait d'autres fonctions, et que les fonctions à l'intérieur de cette fonction-là utilisaient des variables globales à la fonction qui les contenait. Bah, du coup, la question, c'était de dire, est-ce que c'est pas le fait d'accéder à des variables globales? Et il n'en a pas encore parlé, mais en programmation fonctionnelle, on dit qu'une fonction est sans effet de bord quand elle a de la transparence référentielle. Ça veut dire que tous les arguments de la fonction, tous les paramètres de la fonction, sont explicites. Et on n'utilise pas de variables globales, ou de variables qui sont à l'extérieur des arguments, dans la fonction. Du coup, la question qui est posée, c'est, est-ce qu'on réutilise pas des variables globales de cette manière-là? Bah, c'est là où il y a une différence, enfin c'est toujours un spectre, c'est la différence entre si cette fonction-là est interne à une autre fonction, bah t'as le droit parce que c'est privé, c'est private, mais si t'étais dans des fonctions publiques qui utilisaient des variables globales, bah là ça serait problématique. Tu peux coder dégueulasse dans le privé, mais tant que le public est clean, quoi. Non, le langage interdit pas.
En même temps, tu n'as aucun langage qui t'interdit d'utiliser dans un scope, définir dans un scope, utiliser une référence.
Bah, par exemple, en PHP, il force à ce que ça soit explicite avec le user. Tandis que là, en ce cas-là, c'est implicite. Ouais. Donc c'est un peu plus gênant d'ailleurs.
Une question un peu sur le même sujet, c'est là par exemple, on utilise un mix qu'on va utiliser dans les blocs. Si jamais dans une fonction, scope là, on redéclarait une variable, une valeur x, est-ce qu'on aurait un warning qui serait le donné?
Ah, je sais pas, tu peux peut-être l'activer ça. Après, il faut regarder sur Google variable shadowing Scala compiler, et il y a peut-être une option qui permet d'activer les warnings là-dessus. Il y a d'autres questions? Ok. Il nous reste encore deux vidéos.
Last thing, you're starting to know functions as essential building blocks of programs. This week, we'll still be concerned with functions. We will get to know several ways to construct them and to compose them. Finally, next week, we are going to look at data and objects. In the first session of this week, we are going to look again at recursion, and we will find out that there are actually several ways to express recursion. First, let's review function application. You know from the last session that there's one simple rule. You evaluate a function application f applied to arguments e1 to en. By evaluating the arguments of the expressions e1 to en, they will result in the values v1 to vn, say, and then replacing the application of the function by its body, and at the same time replacing the formal parameters of the function by the actual arguments v1 to vn. This rewriting rule can be formalized by rewriting the program itself. Say you have a program with a function definition def f with parameters x1 to xn and a body b, and then somewhere else you have a function call f applied to value argument values v1 to vn. That program can be rewritten to a program that contains the same function definition, but the function application has now been replaced by the body of f, b, and at the same time, time, the former parameters x1 to xn have been replaced by the argument values. And the rest of the program is assumed to be unchanged, which is assumed to be the triple dots here. That's areas of the program that we do not touch. This notation v1 for x1, vn for xn is called a substitution. What we mean by it is that all occurrences in V of the values x1 to xn have been replaced by the corresponding values v1 to vn. Here's an example. Consider GCD, the function of the computer to greater common divisor of two numbers. We know an implementation for GCD for a very long time, since ancient Greek. It's known as Euclid's algorithm. To compute the greatest common divisor of two numbers A and B, what do you do? First, if B is zero, then A is the common divisor of both A and B. And otherwise, you compute the greatest common divisor of first B and then A modulo B. The percent sign here is as in Java and C, means that A modulo, the modulus of A and B. Let's try this algorithm in action. GCD 1421, how is that evaluated? Well, you would expand GCD, so that would give you is 21 equals 0, 14, else GCD 21 and 14 modulo 21. Then you simplify the condition, 21 equals 0 is false. Next, you simplify the if and else using the rules we have developed previously. So if false 14, else GCD of 21 and 14 modulo 21 will give the else part. Once we have the else part, we reduce its arguments to values. That gives us another call to GCD, which we expand, and the process repeats. I have signified that here with the multiple arrows, because I these are reductions that take more than one step. You get GCD 14.7, you get GCD 7.0, and finally you get the condition is 0 equals 0.7, else some other call to GCD, and that finally, since the condition is true here, you get 7. Okay, let's look at another rewriting example, factorial. Classical algorithm for factorial is the following. You say to take the factorial of a number n, you ask again if n equals 0, then the factorial would be 1. Otherwise, it would be n times factorial of n minus 1. Let's apply that algorithm to factorial of 4. So that would expand to following conditional. If 4 equals 0, 1, that's 4 times factorial of 4 minus 1. You evaluate the if and else. That gives you, in a couple of steps, 4 times factorial of 3, second part. Reducing further gives you 4 times 3 times factorial of 2, and so on, until you finally reach 4 times 3 times 2 times 1 times 1. That was the last, the first case of factorial, and that reduces to another point. Question, what is the difference between these two sequences? GCD and factorial. Well, one important difference is that if we come back to GCD, we see that the reduction sequence essentially oscillates. It goes from one call to GCD to the next one here, to the next one here, to the next one here, and finally it terminates. In between, we have expressions that are different from a simple call, like the analysis, but we always come back to this shape of the call of GCD. If we look at factorial, on the other hand, we see that in each couple of steps, we add one more element to our expression. Our expressions become bigger and bigger until the end, when we finally reduce it to the final value. So that difference in the rewriting rules actually translates directly to a difference in the execution, in the actual execution on a computer. In fact, it turns out that if you have a recursive function that calls itself as its last action, then you can reuse the stack frame of that function. This is called tail recursion. And by applying this trick, it means that a tail recursive function can execute in constant stack space, so it's really just another formulation of an iterative process. To say a tail recursive function is the functional form of a loop and it executes just as efficiently as a loop. So as we go back to GCD, we see that in the else part, GCD calls itself as its last action. And that translates to a rewriting sequence that was essentially constant size, and that will, in the actual execution on a computer, translate into a tail recursive call that can execute in constant space. On the other hand, if you look at factorial again, then you see that after the call to factorial n minus 1, there was still work to be done. Namely, we had to multiply the result of that call with the number n. So that call here is not a tail recursive call, and it becomes evident in the reduction sequence when you see that actually there's a buildup of intermediate results that we all have to keep until we can complete the final value. So that factorial would not be a tail recursive. both factorial and GCD only call itself, but in general, of course, a function could call other functions. So the generalization of Taylor's version is that if the last action of a function consists of calling another function, maybe the same, maybe some other function, the stack frame could be reused for both functions. Such calls are called tail calls. After having gone through the exercise, you might ask yourself, should every function be tail recursive? Well, not really. The interest of tail recursion is mostly to avoid very deep recursive change. Most implementations of the daily endpoint can limit the maximum depth of recursion to a couple of thousand stack frames. So if the input data are such that these deep recursive change could happen, then yes, it's a good idea to reformulate your function to be tail recursive, to run in constant stack frames, so as to avoid stack overflow. On the other hand, if your input data are not susceptible to deep recursive change, then clarity comes efficiency and time. So write the function to do it so you can, which often is not tail recursive, and don't worry about the expression that I can. As Donald Knuth has said, immature optimization is the source of all evil. That's a matter of fact, very valuable. Coming back to factorial, you might have observed that factorial grows really very, very quickly. So even after a very low number of recursive steps, it will already exceed the range of integers or even long integers. So in that case, definitely, it was not worth making factorial tail recursive function. So we did an obvious exercise so that you have to take it ready by me. So let's do an exercise on tail recursion. You've seen factorial, and you've seen that that version of this function was not tail recursive. So now the task is to design a tail recursive version of the same function. Okay, so the most convenient way to solve this exercise is using another web sheet. I've already created a new package in our FoxFun project called week 2. And in that package, we have a web sheet exercise, which I've already written the signature of factorial, but I've left out the implementation. So how would we implement that in a tail recursive fashion? Actually, it turns out that we need a... Another function called loop, it takes two parameters, not one. I give you an outline of loop here. So the idea is it would take an accumulator that's also an int and the current value. And it would ask if the current value is zero, then it wouldn't return one as before, but the accumulator. And otherwise, it would return something else. And it would start the program with loop of an initial value of the accumulator and the current value of n. So the question is, what do we need to do to fill in the question marks here? The first task is to fill in something for the initial value of the accumulator. Here it's pretty clear that we say, well, if n equals 0, then the accumulator is returned, so it has to be the right value for n equals 0, and that would be 1. So we pass 1 here. The second question is, what do we do in the case where n is not equal to 0? The idea there is it would go again into the loop with the accumulator times and the current value and reduced by 1. And that's the thing that we compile because we have forgotten to put a result type to loop. Once we do that, the factorial compiles and we can test it. So let's do that. So that would be 24 at second. In this section, we've got
C'est bon pour tout le monde sur ce code-là?
Recursion as a special case of recursion that corresponds to a loop in the program. In the next session, we are going to cover new ways to compose functions.